Steve, thank you
Thank
so
you.
much. I'd just like to share with you this. We met somebody that we hadn't seen for 4 years, and he said to me, "Now you noticed that Mr. Hoberman's talking again." I said, "Yes, definitely." And I can't see him on, but he was so keen to join and see you again. I think lots of people talk about you. We've certainly mentioned you on a regular basis. You're quite famous in South Africa and in Saudi. I'm not sure if you're aware of that. So you're one of our questions in terms of who's the famous data modeler that keeps on thinking about data. And most of them choose Ralph Kimball, but
Oh, I'm in the somewhere up there, top 20.
yeah, we are trying to teach them, but Steve, thank you. Thanks once again. We're really looking forward to your presentation, and thank you very much. All
Thank you.
yours.
Thanks, Howard. Yeah. Thanks, Debbie, too. Thanks for putting this together. I very much appreciate being invited. You can see the slide, right, Howard?
Yes, we can.
Okay, great. Great. So welcome. Welcome, everybody. I'm Steve Hoberman. And it's interesting. A couple years ago, this is actually, we were talking about 4 or 5 years ago. So I was invited, this is probably more like 3 years ago, I was invited to teach a data modeling class to a group of NoSQL developers. And I was told that these are hardcore NoSQL developers. They don't want to hear conceptual, logical, physical. They want to know how to use modeling to build better NoSQL systems. They were working with DynamoDB, which is a key value database, one of these four types of NoSQL databases. So I started thinking, how do I explain how important data modeling is to a group of developers who are already kind of jaded towards not doing data modeling at all? So I went through our material and I started thinking, okay, how can we restructure this for developers? And I came up with this approach, the Align, Refine, Design approach that I'm going to share with you today. And then I started thinking, okay, now that we have this approach, what else can we do with it? So I started thinking, why not try to change the world and impact developers across all NoSQL applications? So not only do I do data modeling, but I also publish books. I've published over 150 books on data, including the DMBOK 2, and decided to find experts in each of the different NoSQL databases, and I could write with them. I'll share the part about data modeling principles and this idea of the Align, Refine, Design approach. And they'll take the Align, Refine, Design approach and make it work for that specific technology. So the book covers you see here are the ones that we have released today, actually. One on MongoDB, which is the number one book right now, I believe, in the MongoDB genre. We were actually at MongoDB World in New York in June, and even the CEO of the company was holding that book up. So that was really nice to see. Elasticsearch came out recently. Cassandra came out this week, actually. I don't know if you know about TerminusDB. It's a kind of a real niche NoSQL database that came out earlier this year, and Neo4j as well. So little by little, we're trying to change the world. We'll have MarkLogic out by the end of this year, as well as DynamoDB and a few others. So keep an eye on this series. So it's a way to change the world. Also, I've been data modeling for, this is my 34th year as a data modeler. So that's kind of a long time, 34 years doing data modeling. This is my email address if you have any questions about the talk, my website, my publishing site. And also, we were talking before I started talking, excuse me, about data modeling zone, which is, excuse me, a conference that we've been organizing since 2012. We did the first one in Baltimore in 2012. And then 2013, we started doing them in Europe as well. And we were doing them 3 times a year, US, Europe, and Australia, right up until COVID. And now we're restarting it. So our first one is in Phoenix coming up in a few weeks' time, actually. Remco, who's on the call, will be speaking there. I was going through a list of participants. I don't know if anybody else on the call will be there as well. But it should be a great way to kind of get data modeling zone up and running again. Somebody suggested Phoenix, like the rise of the Phoenix, and it's in Phoenix, Arizona. So that should be that should be very good. So enough about me. Let's go into this align, refine, design approach. My presentation material is maybe just 20 or 30 minutes. So I'm really hoping for questions and comments. And even if there aren't any during the talk, although I love questions during the talk, so feel free to keep them in. I don't see that. Let me see if I could bring up the chat window as well. If not, I don't know.
I'm looking at the chat window.
Howard, can you interrupt me if there are any questions? Okay, thank you, because I love questions right during the talk. If not, we can chat more at the end. So I always start off my training with this question here. What is data modeling? And a lot of times when I ask this question at different venues, I get back that it's about communication, taking the data that's out there in some kind of ambiguous state and making it understandable. Actually, I've asked this question many times, and I kind of get two different types of answers. I get the answers which are very intangible about, well, it's about communicating the data requirements. It's about connecting data to process. Sometimes I get that, or modeling what the process is. And then I also get the set of answers that relate to something tangible, like, well, it's an important step to get to your database. It's about understanding your systems. So I always like to say it's really about feeling the data. When I was a data modeler, this was 1993. I was a data modeler on Wall Street. And I got, at the end of the year, my manager sat down with me and asked how I like data modeling. And she was sharing what I did well that year and what I need to work on. And one of the things she said is, you're kind of new to data modeling right now. It still takes quite a few years to get good at it. And you'll know you're good when you start feeling the data. And I always love that expression, feeling the data. Because really, that's what data modeling is, about feeling the data. And we wind up with models of different landscapes. If we're lost in a city, having the model of a map helps us understand where we're going. It's a model of a geographic landscape. If we want to know who works for who in an organization, we can use an org chart, a model of an organization landscape. And if we want to understand all the information in our organizations, we can use a data model, which is a model of an information landscape. And I chose most of these slides from my data modeling masterclass. You'll see the little page numbers in the upper right or left. I've been teaching variations of the masterclass since 1992, and Howard and Company and Modelware, they are the only organization in the world licensed to teach the masterclass in English. There's one organization in Germany that teaches it in German, and that's pretty much it. So it's a 5-day class, and I'm just picking a few of the slides out here. But when you think about the map, the org chart, and the data model, what do they have in common? And I love the idea that they're just a simple language. I think that's one of the reasons why once you start doing data modeling, you kind of get hooked. You kind of love it because you could explain so much complexity with only a few symbols. If we're lost in the city, we know that those lines represent streets and we can navigate to a good place for lunch or to get to our destination. If we're looking at an org chart, we know those lines represent reporting relationships. Who works for who? And if we're looking at the lines on a data model, we know for the most part, those lines represent business rules. What is really the relationship between a book and an order? So just a few symbols, you can tell so much. And once readers speak the language, they can discuss the content. Because there's only a few symbols, you can pick it up really quick. And right away, you could have intelligent conversations with your colleagues and explain what's on the model and not waste time because everyone knows how to read the model the same way. So you could jump right in and start explaining. And it all goes back to the word precision. Precision means that we can read the model just one way. Everyone knows how to read the model because they understand the symbols, and therefore we could discuss the content. It's really semantics over syntax. Once you understand the syntax, you can discuss the semantics. And the example I like to give is if we're working for a publishing company, like my one-person publishing empire, somebody might make a statement like this: books can be ordered. And what does that mean? books can be ordered. It's a very imprecise statement. And so much of what we hear in the halls of our organizations fit in this category of imprecise statements. People interpret it differently. Well, we have to make this precise. So we go through a series of questions we have to ask, like, what is a book? What is an order? And then understanding, really, how does book and order connect? So can a book appear in more than one order? Can an order contain more than one book? And we ask a number of other questions too. Can you have a book without it ever being ordered? Can an order exist without having any books on it? And once you go through a whole series of questions, then you have your precise model, your data model. And once you know how to read the symbols here, everyone reads it the exact same way. So you could discuss really whether you agree with it or not. And so this data model is a precise representation of an information landscape. And this definition holds regardless of what technology it eventually helps us build, whether it's a relational database or a NoSQL solution, this definition holds. And really, when you're thinking about why we're doing data modeling, it's all to confirm and document our understanding of other people's perspectives. I always like to compare building an application with that game of telephone we used to play when we were kids, where you might whisper something in my ear, a sentence, and then nobody else hears, and then I'll whisper it in the ear of the person next to me, and they'll do it in the person next to them. And it'll work its way around the room until finally that last person says out loud what they heard, and it sounds nothing like what I whispered in your ear. And everyone laughs. It's usually something silly. But that's really like application development. You're going to whisper a requirement in my ear, and I'm going to whisper it to the person next to me. And by the time it goes through all the business experts and the business sponsor and the business users and the data architects and the business analysts, the data modelers, the developers, the database administrators, by the time it works its way around the room, the last person says what they think they've built, and it doesn't usually match that requirement I whispered or was whispered in my ear. And so in order to minimize that from happening, we use data modeling, because data modeling, because it's precise, we can build a series of models that when we work our way around the room, from the business people to the data people to the technologist, we don't lose anything in the translation. Conceptual, logical, physical, they can be different layers of modeling, but we make sure we have precision the whole way around the room. And it was really fascinating because also right before COVID, I was doing an assignment with probably the largest financial company in the world, top three probably, and they were implementing this massive application in their human resources area. They wanted to create one system to handle all their employee and expense information. It was a very, very big project. And before they started, they asked me to come in and talk to their senior management about what data modeling is and why it's important. And so I don't know if people's schedules were just difficult to coordinate, but they picked a really bizarre time. It was like 5 p.m. on a Friday afternoon on the 50-something floor of one of their skyscrapers in Manhattan, right in Wall Street. And I walked in the room, and I knew nobody wanted to be there because, well, if you're a human resource executive, I don't think learning data modeling would be in the top three things. I mean, you guys would be there because of our love of data and data modeling, but these human resources executives, they're all sitting around this large boardroom table, and I can tell they didn't want to be there. So I actually started the meeting off with a test. I gave them a quiz. I actually brought in pieces of paper, and I asked them to answer a few different questions. Basic questions, you know, like what is an employee? And because it dealt with expenses, I wanted to understand what an expense was, and a few other questions as well. Gave them a couple minutes to write down their answers. And then when I saw they stopped writing, I asked them to share their response with the people around them. And I said, just make sure everyone has the same definition of an employee. And like I expected, there were many different definitions in the room. Somebody included part-time employees in their definition of how they included an employee, and Someone included interns. Someone included contingency workers. Contingency workers were consultants, like the role I was playing, and so on. And so it was really, really apparent in the room that even among these leaders of human resources in the company, they did not have an agreement on what an employee is. And you could imagine if you're spending several years and maybe $100 million on a system to manage employees, we really should know what an employee is before we start. Because if we think of an employee differently, and that system rolls out and it has a different definition of employee that's been built into it, the application won't be a success. So we needed to get a common understanding of what an employee is first. And so that was kind of an important segue into why data modeling was so important for this company. And it goes by different names. The example I gave earlier, where we're all playing telephone and we're going through the business people and then working our way down to the technologist, there's three different levels of modeling that help us make sure we don't lose anything along the way. And in the past, I called it conceptual, logical, physical, and we could still use those terms today. But this group that I mentioned in the beginning of my talk that was doing a lot of DynamoDB development, and they didn't want to hear normalization and traditional modeling terms, I had to think of something else. So I came up with a line refined design. And a line is all about aligning to a common business vocabulary. So it's so important before we start actually getting into the details of modeling to know we're all speaking the same language. And if you're using the word employee, and I'm using the word employee, we mean the same thing. So aligning is about aligning to a common business vocabulary. I used to call this the conceptual, and I still do when I'm working closely with data people who are very comfortable with that term, but I also call it a business terms model, or a BTM for short, because it really is all about coming up with a common set of terms and how they relate to each other. I call it a business terms model because I feel that it aligns more with data governance. And we have to have this really strong connection between data modeling and data governance, and it happens at that high level. In fact, my last few consulting assignments were focused on this business terms level, and primarily I was working with people who work in data governance. So that, to me, is a really important connection. And we can't really talk about requirements until we speak the same language. So that's what that whole align phase is about aligning to a common vocabulary. And then refine is about refining the requirements, being able to, excuse me, you would think, I live in Arizona, you would think that allergies would not be a problem, but this time of year, there's a juniper tree, and the juniper tree just like goes crazy with spores in the air. And
wow.
So for the next few weeks, it's allergy season. So refine is all about taking those business terms that we're really comfortable with and we understand, and deciding what we need to do to build a solution. Refine's a logical, LDM, logical data model, refining to a set of requirements. And a very important property of the logical is that it's completely independent of any kind of technology. It doesn't matter whether we're implementing in MongoDB or Oracle or any kind of system. Logical is independent of all that. And it's really an important level of the model. And then we have design, which is about making it real, taking that logical and making it work for a certain technology, taking that logical and compromising it to make it work for Oracle or Neo4j. So you have these three levels of modeling: align, refine, design. I chose those words because they rhyme. I don't know if you ever did the YMCA song, YMCA. I figured align, refine, design. You can kind of align, refine. So you can kind of get that into your dance routines as well. So align, refine, design. I show the logical as a ring here because It reminds me of Lord of the Rings. The logical is the one ring that controls them all. If you build that logical correctly, it's amazingly powerful because you can use it again and again and again for all your different technologies. So to give you an example of each kind of model, if you think about these three layers of modeling, and you still can call it conceptual, logical, physical, it's all about thinking about your audience. What terms do you think work best for them, and use those terms? For the group of DynamoDB developers, and I started using these terms when I teach now because I realize, at least in the US, there are less and less full-time data modelers, and I'm seeing more and more developers and business analysts in my classes. And in my consulting, I tend to work a lot with data governance. I needed to think of terms that were much broader. So I chose the Align, Refine, Design. So these are our three levels of modeling. Align's about the common vocabulary, refine's about the requirements, design is about making it real, the technology. And then we have three levels of a mindset of looking at the data, relational, dimensional, and NoSQL. And Remco, we can probably add Data Vault here as another way to looking at the data. It would be one of the-
I was already missing that one, Steve.
I was thinking about you as I was going through this. It does relate, depends on how an organization views the Data Vault, whether they view it more as something in the physical because it's about separating the thing from how a thing changes over time, or something that crosses all three levels. That's kind of interesting. But that would also, so view relational, dimensional as NoSQL, and NoSQL as three different mindsets, and there could be more. We could have Data Vault, we could have maybe object, maybe there's other ways of looking at this perspective as well. Yeah, maybe object and UML would be a factor, a column here as well. But these are the three main ones I'll talk about: relational, dimensional, and NoSQL. So that gives us here nine different kinds of models. And to share with you an example of each, here's an example of relational and business terms. What we're doing is we're looking to come up with a common vocabulary. So we're not just delivering a diagram here. We also have a glossary, a set of terms and definitions. So in that glossary, it would have a very precise definition of the word customer, for example. And that would be a whole other talk that would be kind of interesting if we could talk about what makes a very good definition. I review data models as one of the things I consult in. And when I assess definitions, it always is the lowest scoring category when I grade that. And I think a lot of it is, a lot of us don't really know how to write very good definitions. A couple times a week, I'm talking to potential authors, people in our data world who want to write a book. And I was talking last week to somebody who is a, and I could not even pronounce this name even during our call. It's Alexa something, something, something. It's somebody who specializes in the meaning of words. And I'm asking him to write a book on how to write a very good definition, because we need to know that. It's really important to keep the precision on our models. And so this high-level model explains what these key terms mean and how they relate to each other. Because it's relational, and we build relational models to understand the rules that exist in our processes, these relationship lines represent those rules. Each customer may own many accounts. Each account must be owned by one customer. Only one customer, not two and not zero, just one. That's an important rule that this model communicates. The relational focuses on the rules. Most of the time, these business terms models, these conceptuals, fit nicely on a single piece of paper. Dimensional business terms model also usually fits really nice on a piece of paper, but now the focus is different. We're not really concerned about rules. We're really concerned about answering questions. So the dimensional business terms model focuses on some kind of process, in this case, a fee generation process, and then all the different ways of looking at the process, looking at it in terms of, well, by branch, by customer category, whether the customer is an individual or an organization, by month, and by account type. Account type could be checking and savings and brokerage. And once we know those answers, we could look at those measurements at different levels of detail, such as at the higher level of region or even higher district, or maybe up at the year level. So what we're doing in Dimensional is we're really looking to understand how a process is doing. And even though we might decide to use the same symbols because they're so powerful on a relational and a dimensional, they mean different things. On the relational, the lines represent our business rules. On a dimensional, the lines represent navigation paths. How do we navigate through the data to answer certain questions about our processes? Very different way of looking at the data, relational from dimensional. And the same is true with NoSQL. It's really interesting. In working with a lot of the experts in different NoSQL databases and attending a lot of NoSQL classes and kind of educating myself, I am not an expert on any NoSQL solution, but I know a little bit about a lot of them. They all recommend starting with the requirements. And specifically, they either say start with your queries or start with your access patterns. But those two phrases, the queries and the access patterns, really mean the same thing. They say know what you're going to do with the data first, and then build your model around that. So let's say for my publishing empire, I want to know the current bestsellers each month in a data field on Amazon. My main goal, let's say, is to publish a book in the data field before my competitors, and it becomes the number one book in that space. To do that, I want to know, well, what are the bestsellers today? Find out who wrote those bestsellers, and in parallel, find the most influential people in the data space each month. The lines here, they don't represent rules like in the relational or navigation paths like in the dimensional. They actually represent dependencies. What queries have to be run before other ones? So in order to run query 3, we need to do query 1. In order to run query 4 and find out how these people are connected to me on different social media platforms like LinkedIn, I need to know Q3 and Q2. In order to run Q5, I need to know Q4, and eventually I'll see if they want to write a book for me and put a book proposal in place. That would be Q6. So what we're doing is, and I've heard a NoSQL expert use this phrase, and I love it, it's form over function. Form over function. It's about coming up with what the queries are first and then designing your solution around it. And then when you get to the logical level, well, now that we understand the vocabulary and what the lines are, the relational, the lines are rules, dimensional, the lines are navigation paths, NoSQL, the lines are dependencies and queries, we move on to the logical, and we can start talking about requirements. I love the relational logical. And this is fascinating to me because I know Howard and Company does too, because it's so important to what we do, actually. It's really the only model we can create that is where we're capturing what the data means and not compromising it for a certain set of requirements. It's all about building something according to, well, sets, grouping things into sets. There's a reason why the customer attributes are in customer and the account attributes are in account. We're going through a very formal process. It's called normalization, but that's not really relevant here. But we're following a series of steps to build a model that has nothing to do with how the model is actually going to be used to do reporting or to do analytics or anything else. It's a perfect view of the data. And it's painful. It's actually very difficult to build one of these models, but very powerful as well. And this was actually, it's kind of interesting. In writing the series of books on the different NoSQL technologies, this was always a fun discussion points with my co-authors, because a lot of my co-authors who are experts in different NoSQL technologies, they have different opinions on Dlogical and how it should be used. And those are always fun discussions to have during the writing process. This model is very powerful because once you understand what the data means, because you've organized it into sets, you can do a lot of really cool things with it. Then you have the dimensional logical, which is, okay, we want to understand how our process is doing, like the fee generation process. And then we want to see certain measurements, in this case, fee generation count and fee generation amount, at different levels of granularity, like by branch, customer category, month, and account type. And then at higher levels and lower levels. And really what we're doing is we're looking at a series of measurements at different levels of detail. Still independent of technology, we can look at this model and say, oh, this has got to be done in Cognos or Tableau, or we don't know. It's a requirements tool. It's a tool to make sure that us data people have a very clear understanding of what the business needs in terms of their solution. It's a lot like that game of telephone, right? I mean, we're still whispering requirements around the room, but models like this make sure when somebody whispers the word region and the relationship to branch, everyone knows what that means. Really important. And then with NoSQL, most of the time, if we leave graph databases out of it, most of the time what we're looking to do is understand the queries, okay, that was the business terms level, and then put our model in a form that most easily answers those queries. It's really amazing. So if the query is find the customer category that generates the most in fees, if that's our first query, Q1, we're going to start with customer category. And we're going to say, okay, what does customer category contain? Well, once they get the answer to query one, then they want to see those customers. Then they want to see the accounts that those customers own. Then they want to see the fees associated with those accounts. So it's very much a hierarchy. A lot of what we do in NoSQL, if you've been in the industry a while, you might have worked with systems like VSAM years ago. And a lot of what we're doing today with XML and JSON fits neatly into this same hierarchy structure. In NoSQL, with the exception of graph and object, it's really about using the word containment, trying to understand, based on a series of queries, what should contain what. If, for example, if our first query was find the accounts that are most profitable, account would be up here instead of customer category. And then we have the relational. Steve. Oh, is there a question, please?
Yeah. There are a couple. I thought I'd just get to the end of logical NoSQL. We had a question from Crystalline. I know her hand's down, but I promised I would ask her. Crystalline, is there a question there?
Yeah, thank you so much, Howard. And hi, Steve. Thanks for presenting this to us. Sure. Hi, Steve, just a quick question here. You mentioned something that was very key. You spoke about data governance and having a close relationship with data modeling. Okay. And I just wanted to see how those two typically relate to each other and how you work closely with these two. I mean, apart from going doing a full analysis, looking at the data, what's a data scorecard or anything to that effect? How do you do a quick alignment to governance?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for that question. So coming back to the business terms level, the business terms model, the conceptual, connects to data governance with the data governance glossary. So within the data governance group department, there is a glossary that's created, a set of terms and definitions. And what we're doing with our business terms model needs to match to that. If that data governance glossary does not exist yet, we can use our business terms work to create that glossary and work with them. So, in fact, one of my consulting assignments recently was to look at a data governance glossary, look at this insurance company's enterprise conceptual model. It was a concept. It was a business terms model for their whole business, and map them across and make sure they're consistent. That's kind of reactive because they've already been done. But ideally, the modelers should work with data governance to come up with that glossary and make sure all the definitions have precision, because as a data person, we know what precision means and we could apply it to definitions and terms. So the first part of your first part of the answer that actually focuses on the deliverables has to do with mapping the data governance glossary to our business terms model. Okay, that's reactive. And ideally, having our business terms work help create the data governance glossary. That's proactive. That's really ideally where we want to be. Second part of the answer has to do with process, because you also asked, like, how should they work together? I actually think there's an extremely tight coupling between data modeling and data governance. In fact, sometimes I think the whole data governance area was created because of problems in communication between data modelers and other members of a team, and data modelers and business analysts focusing more on process than on data. I think data governance was created to help try to fix some of the issues that existed within IT and the business. And so I see data governance as kind of being the almost like an umbrella, an arch, and the data modelers working within a part of that at that high level. And then, like whispering around the room in a game of telephone, once that's established with the glossary, then the data modelers can work with the technologists to take what was agreed upon with data governance. What does a customer mean? What does an employee mean? And be able to talk about requirements. What do you want to know about a customer? What do you want to know about an employee? So I see that relationship being extremely important. And ideally, I see data governance kind of being an arch over those business terms modelers as well.
Yeah.
Have you, asking a question back to you, how do you see in your organization, how do the data modeling team and data governance, how do they interact usually?
Currently, they're working in silos. And yeah. I'm not sure if we've approached this correctly, because we've done the data, we built the glossary, the data glossary, and then we went on to doing data modeling. I'm not too sure if we should have initially done data modeling first, because data modeling should have defined some of our rules and some of our definitions. Am I correct exactly. in saying this?
You are correct. So, you are correct in saying that. Yeah, because that's what we're trained to do. A data modeler is trained to kind of make things precise, so they can be a very valuable asset to data governance and coming up with more clarity on those terms.
Okay, thanks for that. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you for the question.
So maybe if I could explain just another side to Crystalline. What I like to do is when people write definitions and terms, it's always hard to clarify or vet that those definitions are correct. And one of the comments I make is, if I can't expose a model of the definition or the instance, then we're probably missing a whole lot of rules and relationships between terms. So it's a really nice challenge to anybody writing definitions is saying, well, how do we get the data model from this definition? And if you can't see it, if it was different to what we had, then you probably have a weak definition. So I think they work both ways. And
definitely.
Certainly the other most amazing thing about metadata is that a lot of the business people will come into metadata via the business glossary. So if they want to find an understanding of the data assets or the databases or the data dictionary, where should they come? Where should they start with the business terms that they understand? And that gives us our navigation path into the world of metadata and databases and all those other interesting things.
Yeah. Absolutely. It's that it goes both ways. I think that's a wonderful way to look at it as well. Yeah. Yeah. I was recently working with another. Sorry, go ahead.
No. I there's another question. So
please, let's finish questions. Yeah. No, let's go. Okay. Let's look at the next question. Yeah.
Okay. So Jacques has got a question. He says, I guess this topic might be interesting. So map territory relation, the relationship between an object and a representation of that object as in the relationship between a geographical territory and the map of it. Jacques, I'm not sure whether I fully understand your comment or question.
It was just a comment.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think I understand in the sense that what we're doing in data modeling is representing an information landscape, just like a map represents a geographic landscape. It's a fake view. It's a very filtered view of something in the real world, because the actual thing, like looking at geography, for example, is extremely complicated. You can look at it in terms of topography and lots of other factors. The map just looks at it in terms of one factor. Same thing here with the data model. We can look at a process in many different ways. We can look at it in terms of a data flow. We can look at it in terms of even decision trees and state transition diagrams. Each of those take kind of a fake filtered view of this real complex process. Data model just does that as well. It looks at it in terms of either, well, one of these nine cells. And each of these nine cells are a fake filtered view of something real that's really complex. I think that's a very insightful comment as well. So thank you. Was there another question, Howard?
Yeah, the one question just from me is, I'm sure you may have seen the work done by Terry Smith and Mark Atkins on writing business definitions, Steve.
And they have those six
friends, and they have the what, why, and all that formal classification of a definition, which from there, it's actually quite easy to start creating your data model in terms of the what's and all the related terms. And they use a graph database to show the relationships between the terminology and the glossary. So a very powerful way of helping people get the right definition of any entity or any term they're working with.
Exactly. Yeah, that they have a wonderful approach, Mark and Terry. And actually, we published their book, Data Governance Needs Risk Management. And it talks a lot about how to write. And actually, I love that they have data governance in the title, because going back to the earlier question, it connects what we do in the data side to data governance. So they have a really wonderful approach to writing good definitions. That was one of the discussions that Mark and Terry, we were talking on LinkedIn years, like over a year ago, maybe 2 years ago, and thought, wow, this would make a great book that they're working on, because they have this approach that they've been using for so many years. It's wonderful. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks for bringing that up, too.
Yeah.
Great.
And then I think Remco actually also brings out a situation of when working in ELM on the data vault, they include the definitions. And anything from your side, Remco?
Well, it's more like I completely agree with Steve and other, right? The business terminology and how the business is looking to what is a customer's account and how they work together. That's very important. And one reason why we Hans and I, myself, came up with the whole ELM approach and all the templates we used, just to get this really noted and clear and absolutely spot on, Steve. It is just a view we are having on something what's happening in our terminology, right? Business is talking, they say, this is for us, this is an employee. But then again, is this your employee or my employee? We should be clear on that one.
Mm-hmm. True.
Yeah.
That's good. That's good to see it connects. Thanks. Thank you, Remco. Yeah.
Welcome.
Yeah. So we're going through each of these nine, and you could see how you could then relate it to data governance and relate it to the data vault as well. The dimensional logical, also like the relational logical, we focus on requirements. Dimensional, it's more about analytics. I teach a data modeling class at Columbia University in their graduate program, and it's all about analytics. So we spend a bit more time on the dimensional and doing analytics. I actually teach later tonight. I have to remember to do the, but it's all about focusing on how a process is doing. And actually, maybe this ties nicely back to that earlier data governance question. Everything we do must tie back to a business process. And the business process is also what connects nicely back to data governance. The relational looks at the rules behind a business process. The dimensional looks at the questions you can answer about a business process. And NoSQL looks at what's possible about a business process. More exploratory, more into the unknown around a business process. So, for example, a NoSQL logical might capture a hierarchy that exists within a set of queries, but we don't yet compromise this for a particular solution. Pascal has a data modeling tool called HackoLead. I don't know how many of you are familiar with it, but he has this wonderful term called a polyglot model, which is very similar to what we're talking about here. It's kind of a technology independent view of how to answer the queries, but in a NoSQL structure, in a hierarchy, for example. And then when you cross the line to physical, now we're making something real. We're actually taking, well, in traditional relational modeling, we might be doing denormalization here, or adding more indexes, adding views, doing partitioning, doing the kind of things we do to compromise the logical and make the physical work with our technology. In dimensional, most of the time we wind up with a star schema, like you see here, where you have every subject area, also called a dimension, is in one structure, and there's an implied hierarchy in each of these. And you could go up and down these hierarchies, looking at how well your measurements are doing in each of these. And then for NoSQL, this is where it might be a flattened file. It could be a JSON structure. I call it updating it with a secret sauce, because here's where we would look at MongoDB and say, okay, what can MongoDB bring to our structure to make it really fast and efficient and secure and all those things? So each of the technologies, there's a reason why they're out there. They offer some features that the other technologies do not. And this is where we would add them at this NoSQL physical level. This is a little taste of the 9 different kinds. That concludes my slides. Well, right on the hour, but are there any other questions or comments?
Yeah, Steve, there was. Someone actually asked the question. It was Andrew Fanavati. He said, why do you have a description text for a year?
Oh, where's that? Oh, okay. Let's go back to that one. Was that in the... Cool. Let's come back here. Okay. Yeah, why do you have a description text for a year? That's true, actually. I took this because when I used to work at M&M, M&M Mars Candy, we knew at some point we would have to look at each of our attributes in different languages. The code itself was fine, but we wanted to make sure whenever there's a code, there's also a decode. There's some kind of description or name, even if it appeared like it wasn't making much, it was obvious what it was. So we did it for 2 reasons. One was to be complete. So every code has a decode, like 1 may be male, 2 may be female, 2024, and we would spell out what that is. And 2 was eventually we were going to tie to different languages, and we wanted to make sure all the labels existed in different languages too. But you're right. It might not be required.
And then we have a question from John. John, I see your hands down.
Hi. So hi, Steve. Great presentation.
Thank you.
Yeah. So I don't know if maybe I'm lost, but when I see the table about the relation, we are looking at those relationships within the data model, and when on the dimension, you are saying that. We are looking into all these, the measurements analytics part of the model. And then when you come on the NoSQL, the way I understand it, it's also a type of a database, but not SQL. What about the SQL part? Don't you include it in the model, or maybe this is just focused on the NoSQL databases?
Yeah. So the question, I want to make sure I understand the question too. Do you need to model the NoSQL? Is that the question?
Okay, what I mean is, from my understanding, okay, the NoSQL, yes, it refers like to a database that is not for SQL only. So what, yes, I mean is, can't we have like also a column that, you know, tackles about the SQL database, or maybe in this particular modeling, the applicable one is NoSQL.
Yes, yes. So NoSQL means any database that's not relational. It really has less to do with the query part like SQL and more to do with, mm-hmm, how the data is stored underneath. So of the four, there are four NoSQL kinds of databases that are popular: column, key value, document, and graph. And column, mm-hmm, key value, and document, you can look at more in terms of a hierarchy, like you see here. Mm-hmm. So I want to make sure, though, I answered the question. I explained the NoSQL a bit, but I don't know if I got to the root of the question. If you could elaborate more.
Yep. Okay, so my question is, why don't we include the relation database in this model? Because what I'm seeing is NoSQL. So yes. I think my question, why don't we include the relation database in this model?
Yeah, that is a very hot topic. And that was one of the very important discussion points I got into with each of my co-authors. So to make sure I understand the question, if we're spending a lot of time structuring the NoSQL model to answer a certain set of queries, shouldn't we also have a model that's relational that shows what the data means and how the data relates to other data?
Exactly.
Yeah. So it depends who you ask that question to. Because you're asking that question to me, I would say definitely yes. Because the relational model, this one here, make sure we truly understand what the data means down to an attribute level. And once we have this really good understanding, you can do amazing things with it. You can put it in different NoSQL solutions. If we skip this stage, we're building solutions without really knowing what the data means. Yeah, so I feel very strongly that there's a value in the relational logical, no matter what the solution is.
Yeah, it's Stephen, you also made that comment about the logical being that one ring and many come off the one ring. But sort of where we're going is without that one ring, they're missing those rules and relationships.
Exactly. Yeah, they can build solutions, but they'll get surprises later on. They'll see some data that they didn't expect, and it's because they didn't really understand what the data meant to begin with.
Yeah, so Steve, isn't that almost that column on NoSQL just almost different depths at which the physical model gets built? Not so much that query focused and enhanced hierarchy, isn't it really just the process of establishing the NoSQL design?
It is.
The NoSQL design,
based on a series of queries. So that was the important learning that I got out of all the work I did on NoSQL, was they all talk about knowing what the requirements are in the beginning, and that dictates your design.
Okay, we have two more questions. We got another one. John, I'm just comfortable. Are you okay, John? Everything all right?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. Okay, so Andrew asked a question. He said, for NoSQL, how do we cater for the change if we are modeling? How do we write the queries knowing that there could be a change in the future? So is that where you almost got to throw it away and start again with that query-focused hierarchy?
Yeah. So the nice thing about NoSQL is that it's also very reactive, so that the underlying design could be modified with almost the same ease as changing the code. So the short answer is yes. When the queries change, we'll have to change our design. The longer answer is, it's very easy to change that design, though, because we're not putting a lot of effort into creating the buckets first. We're not putting a lot of effort into creating the structures first and then populating them. So it's extremely easy to change the design. The second part of the answer, though, is that as you get more comfortable with NoSQL modeling, you start using techniques that are similar to our technique of abstraction in the relational. In the relational model, we tend to use more generic structures, thinking that things will change over time and modeling for it ahead of time. If, as you get skilled with NoSQL, you do the same thing. There's certain patterns you could use anticipating things will change over time. The MongoDB book that we published has 17 patterns that you can use, and they're designed to bring more flexibility to the solution. So it has the amount of work to fix a NoSQL model is a lot easier than relational or dimensional. But as you get comfortable with modeling NoSQL, you start building in more flexibility, just like you mm-hmm. would with relational or dimensional.
Thanks. And then question from Esty. Esty, that was only one question this time.
That was only one question. I needed to add a bunch more things. But how would you model something differently for example, for a distributed system? So working on an application that is microservices and had to do the data model for that. So in my head, yeah. I still did a logical data model because for relational, because I want to know all the business rules. That's where we got all the business rules. But with the main change then be from a physical data model perspective, or would you do it completely differently?
I would say that there's two different levels of modeling that you'll probably be working on. One of them is a very broad level. It could be enterprise or organization, and you may find yourself doing a relational align refine designs, a relational align, I would say, for that big picture where you would say, okay, I need to have a business terms model, a conceptual model showing how everything in my organization works in terms of a glossary and relationships. And then you might find for each microservice, you're doing three models, an align, refine, design. The align is going to be a copy of your organization model, maybe slightly customized, maybe not, maybe it'll fit perfectly. And then you'll have a logical and physical, because for each microservice, you need to know what the requirements are, that's logical, and then make it work with your solution. Now, I don't know if the microservices are based in a relational database or dimensional or NoSQL, but that's where you'll need to decide which of these you would pick. So you'll find that you'll have a business terms model for your overall architecture, all the microservices, how they fit together. That's extremely valuable. That's your great connection to data governance too. And then you'll have this logical and physical for each microservice that fits in with this conceptual umbrella. I've worked with a number of large organizations that do that kind of thing, not necessarily for microservices, but for other very large initiatives, and it works really well.
Okay, well, because our distributed systems for all the microservices talk to each other a lot. So there is so many foreign keys, so you almost can't look at just the one microservice in isolation because okay, so in our case, there was five microservices and only one microservice could exist in isolation. All the other microservices needed each other. So then obviously the discussion is, should this be a microservice or not? And after long debates with architects and staff, it is a microservice because of the volume of data that it's eventually going to get. So we want to scale up certain parts, but then it's still a foreign key. So now that foreign key looks different, or well, communicates with APIs. So would you then physical, I don't know, make the relationship API link or something? Like that was something that I was kind of a bit stuck on. Like I wasn't sure how to approach it.
So remember the question earlier that talked about how a data model is kind of a fake view because it's a view of just one part of the process. There's only so much you could model using data modeling in that scenario you just described. We could model each of these microservices, and we could even create a more detailed organization-wide model showing how all your foreign keys connect to other microservices, kind of like a enterprise logical model. But because the data model itself is kind of timeless and stateless as well, it's kind of just a map. If you wanted to show the flows, like how one microservice really connects to another to another. It would require a different kind of model for that. Yeah, so in data modeling, we could take it pretty far. What kind of diagram? I'm sorry?
Like a sequence diagram.
Yeah, exactly. Like a sequence diagram, some kind of flow diagram. There could be better ways to communicate that. The data model would tell you what all the terms mean, how they relate to each other, how they fit, but you need something else.
They need to communicate that part way in normal structures. You know, a foreign key, this is what a foreign key means, and it always means this. Okay.
That's right. Okay. Can I add something there, so Esti, because I think it's very interesting what your question is. But my question would be, instead of looking at all the foreign keys on the microservices and all they're going, did you find time to ask the business people how these microservices are related to each other, even if they are related to each other? Because just a foreign key is just a technical stuff. Because maybe they said, well, that there is a foreign key, but it doesn't mean anything for us to be related to each other. So going out from a more business angle than just from a technical angle.
Yeah, so we did the business angle first. So we did the business rules before we did any, well, business rules, the business level with the business non-technical people to make sure how this relates to this before we did to foreign keys. That foreign keys are just kind of the resolution of how they talk to each other. So we did make super sure that those things are related and need to be related. Like, what are the types of questions they will eventually be asking the system? Do they want to know this type of information or do they want to know that type of information?
Yeah. Cool. I think that's a correct approach, right? Just first, does it need to be related? And then how to be related?
Yeah, I agree. I think that using that term foreign key may work okay at that logical level. I think that when you're thinking about the implementation, you'll probably find that there's a broader term than a foreign key.
Yeah.
Maybe it's a reference or a link or something, because that foreign key implies that you're using a relational database for everything. Are you using a relational database?
Yeah, for individually they're Postgres databases. But between the microservices, it's API connection. So, and I know they're also using object-oriented, so I know the developers talk about objects as well. They don't talk about the table or anything. They talk about objects, and this object is embedded in that other object. So I had to kind of learn what they call it as well, because they don't call it a table, for example. They call it
an object. It's playing that game of telephone, right? You're just whispering things in people's ear. Making sure everyone speaks the same language. Got it.
Exactly.
And I think, Steve, the problem comes as well in data mesh where they break up the enterprise data model across data products and domains. They still have to now link the stuff together. There's always these links that they need to across the different data products.
Exactly.
One more question. Evelyn asks, how often do data modelers tend to have to revisit and rework something that has been previously established and developed? And I suppose that's where we get into the reason for normalization.
Yeah, so it depends. Actually, it depends is always the answer, actually. It depends.
And
it depends
that's what she said. Of course, it depends, asking more.
Yeah, it does. It does depend. What I find, and I think you were going there, Howard, as well, is that if you focus more on this one here, where you're really trying to understand what the data means and how it relates to other data, anything that you build on that, there's a greater chance will remain stable because you already understand what the data means. The only time it would change is if the requirements change, and then you might use a little bit of abstraction to use more generic structures. Like instead of calling an employee, you may use person or party or thing or something more generic. So the short answer to the question is, yes, it does depend. You'll find that if you spend more time focusing on the relational modeling, you'll probably find that less changes over time. And if you working with a team that jumps right to solutions like NoSQL, dimensional, they're going to, and also going back to Esti's question too, the two factors to consider would be, are you taking a relational view and looking at the data in terms of its own behavior and not compromising it for requirements? And also you're taking a very broad view. So if you're looking at things in terms of an organization, and you understand very well what the terms mean in an organization and even the attributes, the chances for things changing are much less. So I think it's about hedging your bets. It's about making sure that less changes over time, and having the relational model and the enterprise model make things more stable.
Evelyn, did that answer your question? Yes, she said it did.
Okay.
Remco's added a few things, and I'm sure every single time you mentioned abstraction, I could see his light flickering on.
No, I think there's something where we have a different opinion. But my last remark on Evelyn's question is that, of course, it depends. But hey, again, I don't think you'll ever finish any data model at all. There's no way that you can say, hey, I'm a data model, I can retire. Nothing's going to happen anymore to the data model. You will always change. You'll always have to do some iterations, some rework, whatever's coming up.
So what I do is I usually focus on what I call the 80-20 rule of modeling, where you get the data model to a point where it's useful and you don't really try to go for perfection. You get it to the point where developers can work with it and other members of a team can work with it. And that's where you get to something that could help the team. Yeah. 80-20 rule is usually what I apply. Yeah. Sure.
Fantastic. Jacques, I'm not sure if that's... I'm not sure if I'm reading something out of context, but it said some people decided to redo the pain sting index to change the rating. Jacques, I'm not sure if it's a question or a comment on something previously.
It was a comment on something previously. It's just something I saw recently. The pain sting index was not like good enough, so they're redoing it. So. It was in the previous comment.
What is the pain sting index? The amount of changes you make to a data model?
Sorry. I could have explained it better. It's like they measure the pain that insect stings inflict, like a different wasps.
Okay.
That's like quite a redo. So, yeah.
It's not something to do with Arizona and the scorpions.
No. Don't bring up scorpions. Yeah, that always scares
me. Fantastic.
Simon, did a scorpion. It was 4 out of 10, apparently.
Okay. Not as bad as a bird's eye view chili. Okay, fantastic. Any other questions for Steve? No. Okay, Steve, thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for inviting me. Thanks for the great conversation.
Really appreciate it. Yeah, thank you, sir.
Same here.
Right. Hey, Steve, please send our regards to Jen and family.
Oh, we'll do. Yeah, thank you. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
You too.
Bye-bye. There's a question maybe from Chris. Chris, is there a last question? Your hands up. I can't see it. Okay, thanks. Thanks, Steve.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
All right. Cheers. Bye. Cheers, Remco. Cheers, everybody.
Cheers.